morning, brothers and sisters. I'm so happy to be here in Muungano. This is a very important church in New Jersey. I think New Jersey City is the biggest church owned by the Africans, more especially the Kenyans. We have members from Zambia, members from Tanzania. We're all over Africa, and it's a church which is there to preach the second coming of Jesus Christ. I've been preaching from this church every Tuesday, Friday, and Saturday. But today I have a very special guest. He's here today. He's my best friend. He's an elder. He's a man who loves the Lord. He says he wants to know nothing except Jesus Christ crucified and who is coming again. Today he's going to share a message from the book of Luke. As I finish, he will come and share an introductory part of what he's talking about. And in 2 minutes, you will hear his sermon. His name is Elder Shem Onditi. He comes from Kisii, Kenya. If you want to know, he's a man of the people and he's a man of the Lord. He has been an elder for many years. He was an elder in Bethel for over 20 years. And he moved in Muungano 2009. And has been an elder in this church for many years. He's a man who gives his heart, his pocket, and his soul to this church and to the Lord. As you listen, I want you to open your ears very clearly. Open your Bible and go with him through the book of Ruth as he shares a message of hope. When we are suffering now and we are in a very bad condition in the United States and all over the world, he has a message for you to encourage you to trust the Lord that there is hope even in the hopelessness of the world. Believe me, he has a word for you. Come and listen to Elder Shem Onditi, for I pray this, believing in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Welcome to Muungano. It will be recorded for me in here, and welcome and listen to his words. Thank you for listening.
Morning and happy Sabbath, brothers and sisters, wherever you are in the whole world. This is a good, beautiful Sabbath. I'm here almost mourning at the pain of standing by this sign of Muungano Seventh-day Adventist Church, the church where Pastor Caius Moses has been preaching, with many members who have been attending this church. And now we have reached to a level whereby the church has been left empty because of coronavirus. Because of coronavirus, I'm addressing this knowing that the emptiness of the church does not mean the emptiness of the message. Today, I'm presenting to you a very beautiful work about the story of redemption, the story of love from the book of Ruth. Come with me, share with me, come meet Ruth. When things go bad and when you are put against the wall, when nothing is working for you, we need Jesus. We need a Savior. In this Muungano today, where Pastor Caius Mose, who is a pastor, has allowed me to preach from in here, I'm going to present to you the book of hope, the book of redemption, the book of love, just from the book of Ruth. And when Ruth stands up in the midst of deciding who to choose, we need to choose Jesus. Like she chose to follow Naomi, we need to follow Jesus. And in the midst of it all, we are going to enjoy it. I welcome you to share the beautiful pastures of Muungano Seventh-day Adventist Church. And as I have the pulpit, let us meet Ruth, let us meet Boaz, let us meet Obed, let us meet Naomi, and let's see how Jesus works in our lives. Thank you very much. You're welcome. Let us open the scriptures. Thank you very much. God bless. Gracious and most loving Father and God who is in heaven, we thank you, God, for the opportunity that you have given us to open your message, to open your word, and to do what you need us to do. We seek for your presence, God, and help me to hide behind the cross of Jesus Christ. May I be belittled and may he rise, so that whatever I say is not mine but him. These are my sincere prayers through the name of Jesus Christ, in whom we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, have you reached in your life in a particular time that you find that your back is against the wall, when things are not working, when things seem to be destroyed, nothing that you try to do works, and at that moment you realize that you are seeking for something else other than what you have been holding to? In the book that we are going to deal with today, we are going to deal with the book of Ruth. when circumstances become hard, when decisions become difficult, when the going becomes rough, the decisions that you have been making all this time, you can't make them anymore. It turns back that now, then, your character is red. Your character is hard. In the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verse 1 through, it says, now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled, and there was famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem of Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, and he and his wife and his two sons, and the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons Mahlon and Chilion, the Ephrathites of Bethlehem of Judah. And they came in the country of Moab, and they continued there, and Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left, and they had two sons. And they took to them wives of women of Moab, and the name of one was Orpah, and the other one was Ruth, and they dwelt there about 10 years. Now, and Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them, and the women were left by themselves with the two sons and the husband dead. Verse 6, then she rose with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab. For she had heard in the country of Moab how the Lord had visited his people in the giving them bread. In this book of Ruth, a unique book by itself, it's just only two books in the Bible that bear women name. One is Ruth, another one is Esther. And of that, only Ruth is a Gentile. The only book in the Bible with a Gentile as the title, that is the book of Ruth. We find out that sometimes when things become bad and good, things, people tend to change character. But when we get in this book and we find Elimelech making a decision of moving away from Judah, the famine had come to Judah. Something that God had promised them in the book of Deuteronomy, that when you go to this promised country that I give you, if you obey me, I'll feed you, I will guide you, I will give you what you need, I'll give you the blessings. But if you turn from me, I'll bring famine to the country, I bring hunger, I bring diseases, I bring trouble in the country. So in the book of Judges, we see a lot of trouble already with the children of Judah. We see a lot of trouble that there was no kings, there was no leadership, there was hunger, there was starvation, there were trouble. And this is why now Elimelech comes in. When Elimelech comes in, Elimelech steps in and decides to carry his family. He's taking his family away. He's going to take his family away from Judah because he's starving. There is a problem here. Where Elimelech is carrying his family to is Moab. Moab were definitely a deadly enemy of the Israelites. They didn't have anything in common with Judah. They had refused to follow the true God. They were worshiping an evil God. They were worshiping gods of the country. They used to give sacrifices of the dead and the sacrifices of the living. They worshiped gods that demanded human sacrifice. These people lived away too far from what Judah used to be. So come to think of it, when Elimelech decides to pack from Judah with his family, he could not call a farewell party. He couldn't pack anything. He couldn't do anything. The only thing he did was to pack his things slowly. He sold his properties. He let go anything he had, and they left quietly and secretly to Moab. When he landed in Moab, running starvation, running hunger, he reached in the country of Moab, and there we are told that he soon died. After him dying, his sons were left with the mother. They soon decided to marry people of the world. They married the Moabites. One of the girls they married was called Ruth. When they did that, they completely gave up what they believed in and what they stood for. The hunger that drove them from home brought them to a family, to a group of people who did not have any belief in what they believed in. When we see chapter 1, verse 6, that Naomi came to her mind and she said, hold on, why did I come this far, far away from home? Why did I come this far, far away from my God? How could I forsake my land, my country, looking for what was good in this place? And I've lost a husband, I've lost my two sons, I'm left here with two widow daughter-in-laws who I cannot withstand, she decides to leave. Brothers and sisters, sometimes when we decide to make our own decisions, when problems come, it is time for us to stand still and wait upon the salvation of our God. Because He still provides. He is still the Father of the mountain and the Father of the valley. He is the God of the daylight and the God of the sunlight. He is there for the dark and is there for the sunlight. When things go bad and when things go good, our steadfastness should remain in our Lord Jesus Christ. Difficulties don't move us. When we run away from Jesus, we seek what is lower. I'd rather live with the difficulties in the name of our God than living with joy in the name of the evil one. For the difficulties in God will always pass away, and soon He will give you daylight. So when Naomi realizes she has lost it, she decides to come back home. And when she decides to come home, when you read that chapter, she starts talking to her daughter-in-laws. I am leaving back to my people. I cannot stay here any longer. This is not my place to stay. I cannot continue living here, because when I live here, the longer I live here, the longer I'm losing what I wanted. I want to go to my people. And when she started saying that, we realized that quickly the daughter-in-laws had to make decisions. Orpah accepts who says bye. Orpah leaves in chapter 1, verse 14. She decides to leave. She decides to quit. She goes back. She says, I will remain. But Ruth says, a completely popular text, a completely famous text. She said, and Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following after thee. For where you go, I will go. And where you stay, I will stay. Where you sleep, I'll sleep. Your people shall be my people, and your God will be my God. And where you die, I will die, and there I'll be buried. The Lord do to me so, much more so also, if I part, and let death part us, not me. What we see here is Ruth taking a very, very strong stand. Ruth decides, in the middle of these hard moments, in the middle of these hard decisions, I'm going to follow you. Ruth says, I am prepared not to leave you, but to go with you. Ruth makes a very, very tough decision here. Ruth seeks to looking to where Naomi is going. She had fallen in love with the faith of Naomi. She had fallen in love with what Naomi had taught her. She had fallen in love with the stories of Judah. She had fallen in love with a God, a one God that they worship. And she preferred to follow Naomi. And when she was told to stay, she said, I cannot stay. I'm going with you. So that wherever you go, I will go. And whatever gets you, it will get me. Where you sleep, I'll sleep. Where you eat, I'll eat. And whatever takes place, I want to be part of you. We find Ruth making a very important decision. Brothers and sisters, sometimes when decisions become hard for us, we need to choose God. We don't have to choose the easy way out. We don't pick exits, but we pick what God expects of us. We seek not what is easier. We don't seek for easy bread. We don't seek for corruption. We don't seek for immorality. We don't seek for going to the world to search for our needs. But we seek that where my God you put me, there is where I will be. Ruth made that important decision. And eventually they left. It's told that in chapter 1, verse 19, it says, when these two went together and they reached in Bethlehem, they were being received. And the people who were there, they were happy to see them. And they told Ruth, they told Naomi, welcome. They were trying to invite to welcome Naomi. But it is said here that when they said that, she said, don't call me Naomi, call me Mara, call me bitterness, call me pain, because I went with my family. I'm coming bare-handed, brothers and sisters. Is there a time away from our God that we quickly find ourselves alone? We find ourselves nowhere. We find ourselves coming back and you don't have anything to show. You run away from what God wants you to do. You go the world like the prodigal son. You go out there, you live and eat with the pigs. You live and eat with dogs. You live in those dungeons. You live in an area that is not like what God had set you to be. You find yourself coming back home in an embarrassing situation. Ruth finds herself coming. Come to think about it. Let us look at it humanly. They were not only sympathizing with her. Some of them were like, come and see Naomi. Naomi who had run away from our God. Naomi who had run away from our faith. Naomi has come back. And guess what? She has come back with a foreigner. She has come with an illegal alien. An illegal alien who is not supposed to be here. She has come with a Moabite. A lady, Ruth, who was born out of an incest type of relationship, a father-daughter relationship. That's what she brought back. And guess what? None of her sons are here with her. The embarrassment of Naomi coming back home was not easy. But the price of coming back to her God, to the God-fearing community, was much better than the embarrassment she was having by people. When we come back to God, sometimes we have hurt ourselves. When we are out there, we have injured ourselves. Our names, our popularity will have gone down. But coming back to God, regardless of what it is, Jesus says, come as you are. I'll take you as you are. God takes us as we are. He doesn't want us to do anything of self-righteousness of our own, because his righteousness is enough. He welcomes us home when we have made mistakes and wandered away from home, wandered away from our God. God still invites us home. He wants us to make a decision Naomi made. So Naomi reaches here. Naomi is smug. Naomi is told everything else. Chapter 2 of Ruth. Naomi reaches home. She's homeless. She has nothing. She has no place to live. She has no place to farm. She has nothing she can do. And she's elderly. She can't even go out there to hustle anymore. But she has Ruth. And she agrees to Ruth. Farms around them. To go and collect any food that are being left from behind from the harvesters. And Ruth, we are told, she left. And when she went to a farm of somebody by the name Boaz. When she met Boaz, in Boaz's farm, she got enough. And when she came back, she told her mother-in-law, I went, I made this place. This man's place is called Boaz. And he was very kind to me. I got this enough. And from that moment, Naomi's eyes woke up. Naomi looked up and said, that man is a kinsman in my husband's family. He belongs to my family. He's part of us. And immediately, Naomi tells her daughter, starts planning how to win, how to get Boaz, how to manage it. And she gives Ruth a magnificent story, which becomes much more, it could have turned out to be scandalous. You go to his house tonight, shower well, dress well, perfume yourself well, make yourself presentable. Go to the tent where Boaz is sleeping. And when you go there, fall by his feet. Touch his feet. Let him feel your presence. Let him come to you and reach out. In other words, Naomi encourages Ruth to go and seduce Boaz. Middle of the night, Boaz finds somebody opening the legs and coming through, and he says, hold on, who are you? She says, I'm the Moabite. I'm Ruth. I'm the one whom you met daytime. I'm the very person who came back with Naomi. I'm here to glean, and I'm here, you are my kinsman. She told, and when she gave the story, he said, hold on, stay right there. I will not touch you. I will not hold you, brothers and sisters. Temptations, when God has blessed us, trials and temptations are thrown to us. But Boaz made a very strong decision. He says, I will not be with you. Tomorrow morning, I will go to the gate. I'll go and meet the rest of the kinsmen. I'll go and present your case. I will bring your case before the throne. Brothers and sisters, when trials come on our way, we can't easily be tempted. This Boaz stands stronger as a kinsman, looks at this young lady and decides what is good before the eyes of God. Starvation, famine, nakedness, all these things will push somebody to do things that are not right. But when you are in a position of helping the situation, we should not be in a position of taking advantage of them. He looks back and says, I will not forsake my God. Like Joseph, how can I do this bad to my Lord who has given me everything except you? Boaz wakes up in the morning. Boaz goes straight. And when Boaz goes straight in chapter 4. We are told that he went to the gate. To the gate where they met. And when they went to the gate, he went to meet the next man, kinsman, who was the immediate kinsman. He had told Ruth, I cannot take you unless that next of kin refuses you. And when he refuses you, then I will take you. But before he refuses you, I will not do that. I will not be with you. He is the first person to marry you. If he refuses, then I will do it. When the gentleman went to the gate, when he met other people, they saw that next of kin passing, they called him in to sit, and he presented the case. He said, listen, this is what it is. Since Naomi came, chapter 4 from verse 4, 5, 6, he said, since Naomi came, have you checked on her? Since they came back to the country, have you checked on her? Have you seen that they have the food? They have the clothes? That they dress well? Have you found out what is expected of them? The kinsman said no. Then he was told, you are the next of kin and you have to redeem them. You have to buy the land back. But other than that, he reminds her that part of buying that, you have to buy the Moabite woman, the lady from Moab. Her name is Ruth. You have to take her as your wife. And you have to raise children on behalf of the dead husband based on the book of Leviticus and based on the book of Deuteronomy. You have to do that. When the man heard, he said, no, I will not take that. Boaz stepped in to take that. When Boaz stepped in, Boaz said, then if you refuse it, I'll take her. Boaz comes back and redeems that Ruth. He says, and Boaz and to all the people, you are witnesses this day that I have bought all that was Elimelech's and all that was Chilion's and all that was Mahlon's from the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth, the Moabite's wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife. For the first time, Ruth had a social security. For the first time, Ruth had a green card. For the first time, Ruth is being called a wife. Ruth is presented now, I have taken her to be my wife, to have the right ownership of my farm, to have the right ownership of my land. I will not let her serve her anymore. I will be the kinsman redeemer. I will redeem her. I will give her what she has lost. I'll give her what Elimelech ran away from. I will give her the land. Remember, Elimelech ran away from famine to the other land. But Naomi comes back and they have famine instead of that. They run away, they come back without a family, but they come back to where food is, that the Lord has visited us. Once again, when starvation came in, when famine came in, it's easy for us to run away, but the Lord has a redeemer in the land. There is still hope in the middle of this epidemic that we are going through, the coronavirus that is killing us. It's easy for us to do things that we are not supposed to do. It's easy for us to be separated from the love of God. It's easy for us to deny the love that how far God has brought us. But it's in the middle of this epidemic that you will be asked, are you becoming a kinsman, redeemer of the people sick? Are you reaching out to the naked people who are not able to work? Are you using your income, your funds, your food? Are you feeding somebody out there who needs this food? Boaz becomes a kinsman redeemer, reaching out to the needy, reaching out to all this. This disease alone cannot stand on our way. These sicknesses alone cannot stand our way. The buffet alone cannot stand on our way. When you are a kinsman redeemer of which we are, because we are all brothers keepers, we still stand looking for a Ruth who is seeking for help out there, seeking for a Ruth who is very vulnerable, falling on our feet. And when she falls on our feet, she's very vulnerable. We should not take advantage of them. We should love them. We should care for them. For the name Ruth means friendliness. We are told to cut the story short, that Boaz married Ruth, and Ruth and Boaz, they got a son by the name Obed, and Obed got Jesse, and Jesse had 8 sons. One of them was David, and David got Solomon. The rest of the story stands up, and generations later, Jesus Christ is born on this generation. Jesus Christ is born under this redemption that was redeemed by Boaz. When Boaz redeemed Ruth, when Boaz redeemed Naomi, he gave them the opportunity to be in the house of Jesus Christ, so that Jesus Christ could be in the same line with Boaz. When you look at this journey, mankind can run away from God, but mankind has a sense of direction to know where his God is. Like the wild animals, like the wild birds, when drought has come, there's no water in the land, they know which way. They all start moving from Mara, from Masai Mara to Serengeti going down. They start moving from Serengeti coming back to Kenya side. Why? Because their senses directed them. The senses of Naomi directed her that go back home. God is still there. The God of the mountain is still the God of the valley. Go back to where you came from. In that place, there is redemption. When Ruth becomes redeemed by Boaz, Boaz gets in the genealogy, stands up to gain. She gets into Ruth. Ruth gets Obed. Obed gets onto Jesse. Jesse gets into David. The story is very simple. They look back today. They became in the history. She's not known as a Moabitess anymore. She's not known as a widow. She's not known like an illegal person. When you come in Jesus Christ, Boaz says, now this is my wife. When we come to Jesus Christ, when we have wandered away too far, he's our Redeemer. He says, now this is my child. This was my son who was lost and is found. This was my son who had no hope of living with me, who had chosen the world, but he has come back. He gives me a name. Boaz gives his lady a name, my wife. Jesus gives us a name, my child. And he demands to be our Redeemer. In the midst of sicknesses, in the midst of pain, we need to remember that God never forsakes himself. God never forsakes our people. He never ever fails to be our Redeemer. If you think I'm lying, ask Joseph. When he was thrown in the pit and everybody was passing by, his Redeemer was there. When he was sold to those Egyptians and he was saying the Pharaoh's home, his Redeemer still took him through. When he was in prison, his Redeemer was there. If you don't believe me, ask Moses. When he had to cross the Red Sea and he had to divide the Red Sea, find out who the Redeemer was. That's my King Jesus who redeemed them. When in the wilderness and the starvation and the hunger was running around them, ask him who was his Redeemer. He will say, my Jesus was my Redeemer. If you are not enough, ask Elijah when he was in the cave, who was his Redeemer? He will tell you, my Redeemer was there. He sent the ravens to feed me, and I never starved. I never ran out of water. If you think, ask Samson when he became totally blind and they couldn't see, and they had been, the eyes had been taken off, and he was being punished by his enemies, and they cried, Lord, give me this one strength. Let me avenge my enemies. Let me punish them. And they gave him that strength, and they pulled that building down, and they punished more people than he ever punished them before. If that's not enough, ask Hannah. Hannah, how was it like when you didn't have a child, when you were being mocked? She said, I prayed to my Redeemer. I prayed. I depended on him, and they gave me Samuel. If that's not enough, ask David. When David had to be chased away with the spear day in, day night, and they knew who was his shepherd, and they believed he would never perish. He believed that he can lead him through those pastures. If that's not enough, ask Hagar. When Hagar was no more, when Hagar was chased away with Sarah from that home, and she found herself in the wilderness where there was no water, nothing else, leaving Hagar on the side, Hagar not knowing what to do, ask her who provided food for Ishmael, who provided water for Ishmael in the wilderness. If that's not enough, ask Sarah. At an old age, how could she make Isaac? And she made Isaac to become the father of all generations. If that's not enough, ask Jonah. In that stomach of the fish, how could she survive? How could he hold on to it? ask yourself, who was the Redeemer in that stomach of the fish? When he was thrown off with the whale, he had to praise his Redeemer. Our Redeemer is in the midst of our challenges. When things go wrong, when John is in the island of Patmos, he still depended on his God. Ask him who kept him company other than the mosquitoes and the insects. His Redeemer was there. Brothers and sisters, this coronavirus, our starvations, our Redeemer is there. In foreign countries where we are living, our Redeemer is there. When we are mistreated and mishandled as foreigners, our Redeemer is there. When you are called a Moabite, your Redeemer is there. When you walk naked, your Redeemer is there. When you sleep hungry, your Redeemer is there. When you don't get the school fees, your Redeemer is there. When there's no home for you and you are homeless, your Redeemer is there. Because we serve a risen Savior who came in and died for us and gave us a second chance. Do you know? After 27 generations later, when Jesus Christ is born, Jesus Christ is born in Bethlehem, the same place where Boaz married Ruth. It's the same place Obed was born. It's the same place David was born. It's the same place Solomon was born. It's the same place our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, was born when Joseph came into that place with Mary, and they didn't have a home, they didn't have a place, they had to sleep in a cow place, they had to sleep in a manger, just like Naomi coming back without a place to sleep. Mary and Joseph come into Bethlehem and they sleep in a place without anything. Our Redeemer is still in the land, in the middle of all these trials, in the middle of the fire. Our Redeemer liveth, and we shall always hold him in times of difficulties. He is our Savior. Present before you my heavenly Redeemer, my Jesus who died for me at the cross. And until that moment, let us hold through him. Amen. God bless you. Let us pray. Precious and most loving Father in heaven, we thank you, God, for the opportunity that you have given us, the time that you have shared with us, God. We thank you for the loving kindness and your mercies. We thank you, God, for this church. We thank you, God, for the Pastor Mose Kayus and the beautiful ministries running here in Muungano Seventh-day Adventist Church. We thank you, God, for the membership. And we thank you, God, for the support you have given us. So for this moment, as we finish this hour of worship, we see, God, that you continue being with us for the rest of the day. Through the name of Jesus Christ, in heaven we pray. Amen.